9/11, never forget. 19 years ago today is when it happened. Many of you have learned about 9/11 as history. But I am all too aware that for far too many of you, almost no time has passed. And to you, my best, as always. I have thought a lot about what to say tonight. It is a special 9/11 because we come to it in the midst of yet another crisis. And I do have a closing argument for you later in the show. But the headline is, the moment we're living is proof that never forget applies. We need to remember something that we promised to never forget. Make no mistake, we are under attack again. 200,000 dead almost, 6 million plus sickened. Many of them haven't recovered from COVID-19. Get used to the term long haulers. I am one, but I am lucky compared to a fast-growing number who are enduring so much worse. The numbers that we're dealing with in this are much greater than the attacks of that day. But back then, we were in a special place that we are not even close to today. We have none of the resolve, the rectitude, the sense of right and wrong, the sense of what we mean to each other. And as much as leaders today seem to want us to see an enemy in each other, it doesn't have to be this way. Look at this. Look what happened today. Joe Biden, Mike Pence, this is an ugly race as I've seen, but knocking arms in a good way, at the 9/11 Memorial in New York City. A pandemic-era elbow bump at the height of a really bitter 2020 election. Why? Because a moment is much bigger than politics, much bigger than an election. Both of them masked up, because that's not weakness, that's strength. You're going to commemorate a day where people were taken. You do it by honoring the need to keep as many people here as you can. A present national tragedy that is not getting the response we gave it back then. I know it's different. I know it's very different. And yet, what it takes to get through it is not. Trump said in the campaign, maybe he could have avoided 9/11. He shouldn't have said it. And I'll tell you what, I lived it. And when it hit, he was nowhere to be found. And plenty in the private sector stepped up. They were drawing on the example of a president who hadn't been that popular, but he rose to that moment. He commanded our attention to care about one another. And there was somebody else. There was a mayor I watched every day, literally come out of the ashes with strength and straight talk, eye-popping, straight, scary talk. It made him America's mayor. Just having him on the show tonight is a sign that no dispute should render us incapable of the decency and the humanity that we see in one another. Even in the worst of times politically, we can always be together. And former New York City Mayor Rudy Giuliani, it is an honor, especially on 9/11, to have you on the show. I've missed you.
Well, it's an honor to be back, and it's also a very, very unbelievably important day. I know for me and for my city, for many, many reasons, very horrid reasons, and as you pointed out, some really beautiful, beautiful things that happened as a result of that terrible attack.
So I know, you know, we've spoke about this so many times over the years, but it bears some reminding for the audience who doesn't know you as well today. You were in shock first couple of days. You were in just straight duty mode, trying to figure out what was going on. Nobody knew anything. But you made decisions. You got on your feet fast, and you started to tell us what you were learning as you were learning it, even when it was so frightening. And we were all living on edge then that it was going to happen again. You know, people forget that. We didn't think it was a one and done.
I know they do.
Why? Well, did you feel that you could tell us that kind of stuff and not freak us out, but shore us up?
Well, it took a little while, actually, Chris. You're absolutely right. When when I arrived at what is now Ground Zero for the first time, the second plane had just hit. My police commissioner told me it was definitely a terrorist attack. The one advantage we had was I was in office for 7.5 years. We had been training obsessively for a terrorist attack. We had been attacked in 1993, right before I came into office. When I came into office, I established an emergency management center that we never had before. And we would constantly have terrorist threats. So we must have had 4 or 5 exercises and maybe 20 tabletop exercises. We had 25 different emergency management plans. And I actually thought, I was writing a book about leadership. I actually thought we were prepared for anything, probably a little bit arrogant. And when I arrived at the site and I was told to look up because debris was coming down and it was hitting people right near me and knocking them on the ground, and some of them died. I looked up and I saw a man on the 101st floor. Mm. And this is a memory that stays with me, I think, every day. I've watched him throw himself out the window, and I watched him come down. And I grabbed my police commissioner's arm, Bernie Kerik, and I said, Bernie, this is beyond the two of us. We got lots of plans. We don't have a plan for this. So you and I are going to have to just stay calm. We're going to have to make the best decision we can make. And then we're going to have to pray to God that it was right, because we're not going to make all the right decisions.
We're showing the video, by the way, the day when you were approaching, Rudy, just so people know. The man who grabs the mayor's arm for a moment, who has no jacket on, it comes in about 15 seconds or so. So we were there. The mayor was walking around, kind of figuring out what was going on. Everything's still happening. Everything is moving up the streets. Bernie Kerik comes, grabs him. He moves Bernie off him and then kept moving forward. And that was really your disposition from that day on. But you were doing something. Look, I could have done the management exercises that you guys were doing. I could never do what you did in the days and weeks and months that succeeded the event.
You probably could have.
No way. And that's okay. That's why you were built to lead, and I was built to report on people who lead. But when you were telling us the things that you were telling us, not just the media, when you were saying, look, this was bad, there are a lot of dead people underneath this. This idea that people are alive on the mall, stop saying it, stop suggesting it. It's too hot down there. This fight between NYPD and the NYFD about if they could have gotten to the top of the roof, you made sure that people knew, stop it. No one was going to live up there. The heat was unbearable. We can show it to you.
Yeah.
What gave you the sense that the city and really the country and the world could handle the reality?
Well, the first night I wasn't sure. So you might remember the end of my press conference the first night, I was asked, how many casualties? I was about to say it, and I said, I don't think your people are ready to hear this yet. Because I had been told, actually, originally it was 12,000. At that time, I would have said 6,000. The reason there were much fewer casualties, by the way, is the unbelievable heroism of the firefighters and the police officers, who got the people, more people out than anybody expected you could get out in that period of time, which is documented in the 9/11 report.
Yep.
So I wasn't sure. And then the second day, I was like, I wanted the city to come back right away. I called up the stock exchange. I said, I want you to open tomorrow. And Dick Grasso said, can I come over and talk to you? And I wanted Broadway to open right away. And I wanted, and people were resisting me. And by the third day, I realized, first of all, I had to let people mourn in their own way. And I could start telling them a little bit more of what they were going to face. So by the third and fourth day, I started to get them ready for the fact that, we weren't going to have any survivors. I knew that. I knew that the afternoon of the first day. The coroner told me, I went to see the coroner at 5 o'clock on September 11th to find out how many body bags I needed. And he told me none. And I said, this can't be possible. I need a couple of thousand. He said, you're not going to need any. Do you realize those buildings melted? So now if those buildings melted, what do you think happened to the bodies? I said, well, I guess they melted. He said, you're going to identify these people with DNA. You're not going to identify them the way you're used to being a prosecutor and doing homicide cases. And I mean, that just stunned me. And it took me about 2 days to absorb that. So I knew I had to prepare people that, first of all, it was after about 3 or 4 days that I finally announced that we weren't going to have any more survivors. But I knew that at 5 o'clock in the afternoon on September 11. So I tried to feel my way through, Chris. I mean, I honestly, I would make a decision, and then I'd say a little prayer, and I'd say, God, I'm not sure I made the right decision. Please make it right. You make it right, because this is beyond me and George Pataki. I also had a wonderful partnership with the governor. It was, he was very, very willing to allow me to sort of run things, which of course is natural because I understood the city better. Mm. I mean, he knows the whole state. I grew up in New York City. I had the fortune really then of having been the chief prosecutor in New York for 7 years. I knew every part of New York City. So he deferred to me in a way that a lot of governors might not do.